think.
That's a beautiful picture.
Isn't it? It's amazing what you can find on the internet. So, again, welcome to the December Roundtable. Wendy and I will be talking to you about Pinewood Derby tips and tricks. This is something I've collaborated with Jim Steele and Patrick Montemurlo in Mount Tahoma with. We've kind of all taught the Derby's class over the past several years. So I do have their input and want to give them their credit where it's due. I really want us to all give another round of applause to Jamie, Brandy, and Hannah on your Den Leader Training Awards. This is such a big deal. And this is one of those things that if you put the time in, you can absolutely achieve it, but it's only for the people who have put the time in. So thank you, ladies, for your amazing dedication, as I said earlier. But for those of you who are thinking, okay, well, I'm a den leader and I don't know how to get this. Basically, it's based on your training, tenure, and performance requirements. So I have a link to the requirements. And like Ken, I'm not going to go through each of them with you, but they will have needed to complete an extra training. Under performance, they need to meet at least 5 of those goals, have a tenure of a minimum of 12 months. And so these ladies put in that extra effort and their pack will be all the better for it. So I encourage you, if you're a committee member, please go ahead and share this with your den leaders. If you're a den leader, please notice that you can actually get it for the Wolf Bear and Weeblos. Chris, is that still true?
Yeah. You get to get the different, when you earn them multiple times, you can get a little device, which is a little shiny pin that you get to put on your knots. So you can get like a tiger device if you earn it as a tiger leader. I think Wolf and Bear is the same device. And then there's a Weeblos device. So you can earn it multiple times and then make your knot all shiny and pretty.
So yeah, I think that's very impressive. Another round of applause to everyone who did complete them. I want to go through some quick announcements and reminders. I wanted to show you our Alpine District page. I know people have been saying, oh my gosh, what's postponed, what isn't, whatever. Alpine has done this beautiful job of reworking the website. And if you just go to seattlebsa.org/alpine, it'll bring you to this website right here. And as I scroll down, I mean, I'll let you look through it, but right here is our previous November roundtable recording. It tells you when the next roundtable is, but it also has, if you notice over here, camping and hiking and—
you're seeing your screen. You're seeing the slides.
Okay, is anyone seeing the website?
No, all we're seeing is the slide.
Oh, well, then you have no idea what I'm talking about, and I apologize.
I opened it up on my other monitor, but yeah.
Okay, so I apologize, but it's reformulated. It is the place for Alpine information, so I wanted to highlight that that had been updated. I apologize that you couldn't see anything, but that's why What's Happening is right there. There's a secondary link also. Nationals put together just... if you have a question about how COVID affects scouting or beginning scouting or anything, they have the FAQs right there. That's a great place to start if you have questions, because it'll give you kind of what National has. You can combine it with what you know your county guidelines are, and then you'll be pretty sure where you stand. Chris spoke to this, but recharter really needs to be done. I was a committee chair, and I know that it can be a pain, but thank you to the over 50% of people who have turned theirs in. So, first, I'd like to open a discussion about why we have derbies. I have a list of things here, but what are some of your thoughts?
It's a fun tradition.
Yeah. Yes. It's something to look forward to. It's on your annual calendar. Thank you, Joaquin.
This is a great list.
I hear someone, but it was quiet.
Oh, I said this is a great list.
Oh, yes. And this list is kind of just what we came together with. It's not exhaustive, of course, though. I really think learning about competition and sportsmanship is one of the most impressive things that we can teach our scouts. You can see who has a sense of fair play, kind of just how they interact and things like that. And it's a great opportunity to fail forward or succeed, or, you know, really just make it that atmosphere where the scouts are able to do their best and have fun. The Pinewood Derby process is seemingly simple. you get the kits from council. Let's pretend it's a normal year. So, you know, you go in. If you have free cars, you want to go in when you've completed recharter and the most number of people are on your roster, because that's when they will give you your free cars and you cannot pick them up more than once. So you'll want to make sure that all your Lions and whoever are on that list. But then once you have them, you got a box of cars. How are you going to distribute them? How are we going to build them? What is the check-in process? Then we hold the race, we hold the award ceremonies, we get the kids back their cars, and then we send out a feedback survey. And I guess I should have put at the very beginning, we review our feedback survey from the year before. And I wanted to talk about a couple different types of scoring here with you. There's the single elimination bracket, and this is going to very much depend on your pack size. It's the easiest, it's the shortest, but each kid only gets to race once. Double elimination brackets. Oh, no. Okay. They do let the scouts race twice each, but be careful that you don't refer to anything as the loser's bracket or anything. It's just, you know, your second chance bracket or, you know, runner-up bracket. And then there's a free site for the brackets right here at challenge.com. I know that looks funny, but so if you were interested in doing one, that's where you could find that type of bracket. And then an alternative would be a cumulative points winner bracket. So you would have a fixed number of heats, let's say you're doing three, and it's a cumulative points per winner. So each race will be the cumulative. And what's nice about this is you can kind of control the event duration a little better with it. But that is another way to score the Pinewood Derby. And then, of course, awards. So scouts should be recognized. Consider doing both den and pack level awards, so you can have your top pack people, but then each child gets an award. Multiple tiers and categories. So when we did the Rain Gutter Regatta, the first place in whatever was captain of best build. And then, or I guess that would have been third place. And Admiral was first place. So you can do things like that. Do not forget the craftsmanship award categories, because that's where our creative scouts get recognized. They may not be the fastest down the track, but maybe they use the most glue. Or, you know, maybe it's the most over-designed. And, you know, that's still fun because they're still getting rewarded and recognized for their time and what they're doing. And you can make up these awards during judging to reward extra work. So I'd like to open a conversation about how we currently do our awards as a group.
One year we had an award that was titled Most Unusual, and my daughter won it or received it, and she thought it was just the best thing ever. So having, even though it was a crazy title, it was very important to her.
Yeah, that's, yeah, most unique. I mean, who doesn't want to hear that? Okay, well, thank you, Jamie, for your, so, this is still to be an open discussion, and you're going to hear these questions again in the video I will be showing for you very shortly, but you know, the conversation I want to have right now is, what do you want your parents and Cub Scouts to say about your event? How do you want them to feel? Are you following up with Scouts and parents? And in what form? Are you able to take it as non-personal advice and lead change? Or are you seriously attempting to adapt and just hitting some barriers or whatever? So I would appreciate it if everyone would unmute and kind of mull over these ideas, because I think it's important that we remember what we want out of our events, right? Because it's a game with a purpose.
I think with a Pinewood Derby, three things are pretty important. Fun is way up there. You know, I think it needs to be fair. Because, you know, kids are going to be upset if they don't feel like something was fair for them. And then also, maybe especially for the parents, you know, to be considerate of the time, you know, make sure that the plan, so, you know, you're not spending, you know, over 2 hours on a Pinewood Derby race, because that will become a lot less fun at that point. It brings all back.
I think Chris, of course, is speaking from experience there. but
maybe, I know.
But yeah, that's all important advice, and those are important things to be considering during your event. Anyone else?
Could you break it up, like, just into dens, just because the little guys, like the lions and the tigers, they just can't sit for those 2 hours that you're talking about. So can you make it like just they can, or does it have to be a whole pack?
So here's what I'll say, is there are official rules that come with the Pinewood Derby cars. But the real question I'm wondering for you is, why can't you just do it by dens? If it's not, you know, an official pack race, that's okay. I mean, I would think, obviously, you know, if you're doing it at the pack level, keeping tigers entertained, wolves and bears too, honestly, having extra games going on in the background, things like that can be done. But my real question would be, why can't you do it that way and just reimagine it, you know, the way that you see it? I think one of the coolest things about Cub Scouts is it's not just the Cub Scouts that get to try things and learn things, right? We learn things about the types of teachers we are and all of that. Anyone else want to participate in this? The feel of the event?
I'm curious if you have suggestions on how to do this virtually this year, because, you know, running games in the background is really easy to do in person, but we're struggling with what to do virtually. We usually have our derby in January, so we'll definitely need to have it online. And we were kind of struggling with the same thing that Brandy said. If we do them separately, if we have, you know, a different race for each den, and then we just tell them who'd had the fastest overall or whatever. But I'm curious if you have in here and in the future slides or whatever any tips or tricks for what to do or how to organize it that way.
Yes, absolutely. If by the end we haven't really gotten to that, I will address specifics with you if you would like. But I think it would be a good idea to let's watch this video, see what we all think of this. This is from National. They always give Roundtable commissioners like a little video to show. So I thought this one was actually pretty good. It covers things very well. And so enjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
Don't enjoy. It's coming through the...
We can hear it, Kat.
Oh, you can.
Yeah.
Thank goodness.
Oh, it is okay. Race day.
Thank you.
That's right. It's Pinewood Derby time. I don't know about you, but I'm ready for this. This pandemic has taken a lot of things away from us, but I draw the line when it comes to Pinewood Derby. The smell of freshly cut wood, the blisters from sanding, and the feeling of graphite underneath my nails. It's Pinewood Derby. Here we come. Now, welcome.
I lost audio. I don't know if anyone else did.
Yeah, I don't hear it anymore either.
I've been muted. I'm so sorry. Let me try to screen share this, maybe. Probably can't.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it is race day. That's right.
I can hear it.
It's Pinewood Derby time. I don't know about you, but come on. When it comes to Pinewood Derby, the smell of freshly cut wood, the blisters from sanding, and the feeling of graphite underneath my nails, it's Pinewood Derby. Here we come. Now, welcome to Roundtable. We're going to share tips and tricks to conducting a successful Pinewood Derby race. Is the result you can be in person? I will show you some items that will take your car design to the next level, because some Pinewood Derby cars are built for looks, not necessarily for speed. We will also want you to share with your fellow leaders some of your best proven techniques. Like any great event, things just don't happen. It is the result of planning. So the first thing to do is to have a discussion about your Pinewood Derby. Start with these questions. When the event is over, what do you want parents and Cub Scouts to say about the event? How do you want them to feel when it's over? If you have done a Pinewood Derby in the past, have you followed up with participants, both parents and Cub Scouts, for feedback? What do parents and Cub Scouts like about it? What do they not like about it? If you have not asked, now would be a great time to find out what families are thinking. When you ask these questions, be prepared to make changes to the event if the majority of parents want a change. Now, for example, the first Pinewood Derby I did as a Cub Master, we conducted it on a normal Tuesday night pack meeting. After the event, we asked parents what they liked and what they didn't like. Our parents said it was a great event, but it felt rushed. With that feedback, we made the decision to move not only next year's Pinewood Derby to a Saturday, we also decided to move the upcoming Blue and Gold to a Saturday so that it wasn't rushed. Not only did we learn lessons for the next Pinewood Derby, we also took those lessons and applied them to other events. Now, you have decided on what you want to accomplish with your Pinewood Derby and what kind of event your parents and Cub Scouts enjoy. It's time to start planning. This brings us to our second step, managing expectations and having simple rules. Now, managing expectation starts immediately and is reinforced leading up to the event. When it comes to managing expectations, let us talk about the elephant in the room. Who actually builds the car? So let me address this by saying a method of Cub Scouting is family involvement. For my pack, this tied into our first step of why we were having this event. We used Pinewood Derby as a method of Cub Scouting by giving a chance for adults to work with their child on a project together. We kept our focus on that as our purpose. We provided workshops with access to tools for adults who didn't have them. We also shared all the tips and tricks to building a fast car. No secrets. This was a real learning opportunity for both Cub Scouts and parents. This is something that your local scout shop may be hosting soon too. We also kept the awards for the races small and simple. That's managing expectations. Keeping the rules simple is easy, because in every box of a Pinewood Derby car kit is a set of rules. Our pack used these rules. This avoided families claiming they didn't have the correct set of rules. A tip from the experts is to have an opportunity for adults and other family members to make their own car and have their own races. This is where crazy additional rules can come into play, and in some cases, no rules at all. It's super fun, and you can keep it out and away from the Cub Scouts Pinewood Derby race, and that way you can keep your rules simple. Now, on to the third step, and that's logistics, or the physical setup of your race. Now, this is where we hope to inspire you to be creative based on your local regulations on gatherings during the pandemic, access to your facilities, and the comfort of your families with in-person activities. Now, a tip from the experts is to provide a Pinewood Derby car to each Cub Scout in late November, early December. This gives the winter break and holiday season for the Cub Scout to have time with an adult or other family members to work with their car together, and then conduct your race in January. Number one logistical item is having a track. We could do a whole discussion about tracks. For planning purposes though, just remember two things. Confirm that you have a track early and set the track up prior to race day with enough time to address any needed repairs. The second logistical item is location. This is where knowing your local rules and regulations about gatherings is important. And how?
Okay, I can see people are feeling a bit frustrated, and I can totally understand why. Did my most recent attempt to screen share match the video with the sound?
Yeah, we just got it.
Oh, perfect. Okay, so the rest will be much better, and then you're invited to rewatch the beginning, and I am really sorry about this.
You conduct a race. You may be able to use the same location you've used in the past and have enough room to have social distancing between different families. Or on the other end of the spectrum, you may can
It's like we lost the audio.
Yeah, we lost the audio again. Guess we can't get both audio and video at the same time. That'd be asking too much.
I think it may be that the audio gets muted when Kat gets muted.
Oh, that's a thought.
Oh, whoever figured that out, you're smart.
Virtually.
Does that work?
Once you've decided on a location and what method, in person, virtual, or something in between, the next step is to plan out how you will check in the cars. Some large packs have developed a process over the years that also works well with conducting virtual races. This process sets a separate date and time that is before the race, where Cub Scouts turn in their cars, and the cars are then secured until race day. Checking cars in is not only time consuming, but it isn't much fun. So by having this as a separate activity, it makes race day all about having fun. Here's a tip from the experts. You want to check each car to make sure it meets the specifications outlined in the rules. This handy device is less than $6 and makes checking the car measurements quick and easy. In addition, you want to make sure that no car is over 5 ounces, which means you want to have a good scale. Now, once a car is measured and weighed, you take the car and place its official race car number on the car. Most people put it on the bottom. The car is then stored and not sent home with the youth. So yes, That means someone will have dozens of Pinewood Derby cars to contend with. But this system ensures that before a car goes on the track, it has been inspected. Our last step to a great event is to find a way to make it special. Now, our pack would do where we could to make it look like and feel like a raceway. So we had a snack bar, a pit stop for repairs, music, and decorations. It all made it for a very special event. Today's Pinewood Derby cars have great options for design, including lights and sound, paint, stickers, and wheels that glow in the dark or glow under blacklight. Now, that's inspired me to think of having a whole race done in blacklight, or maybe one completely in the dark, or maybe we could, I got a little off track. Get it? Off track? What can I say? Old Codemaster habits die hard. Now it's time for you to share with your fellow race fans. Take the remainder of the time to share your proven techniques. Here are some questions to get you started. How do you plan to conduct your Pinewood Derby race? In person, virtual, or a hybrid? What one thing does your pack do that you think makes your Pinewood Derby a success? How do you keep your Pinewood Derby a friendly competition? All right, thanks for being at Roundtable. Look forward to seeing you next time.
All right. Then let me share the PowerPoint again. Here we go. I apologize. I am learning about some newer technology. So the race, or the questions he asked towards the end, and I did see Quentin's comment, I think are worth considering, and I'd like you each to kind of read them, but we don't need to discuss them in depth if you don't want to.
So one of the things I was thinking of is if you have this capability, you know, with all the, you know, making the cars and everything, make sure, you know, if you get that out to all the families, get the kits out, and, you know, maybe even have a virtual meeting about how to, you know, do some basic car shaping or whatever. But maybe for the actual race, if you're able to maybe like live stream it, you know, get like a demeter who's really tech savvy and exciting and who's the MC, and who, you know, who gets all of the vehicles, but then they conduct the race and maybe live stream it, and that people can log in and watch it. I think that is a potentially good way to get around, because obviously if you have, you know, 50 people, you can't have them all crowding around a Pinewood Derby track, and that just doesn't work. But you could maybe get some, you know, get a camera, you know, up looking up at the track and having the cars come down. So that's a thought. You know, I don't know if that, how exciting that sounds. That's something that I've thought of. I don't know. What are your thoughts?
So that is how my pack actually set things up, and I'm happy to run through that. But let's see if we can get some inter ideas here.
That's how we plan on doing it in May. So we're pushing it out in May, hoping that things get better, but who knows?
Yeah, right.
But our plan all along is to do it outside, only four adults being there, no kids, live streaming it, you know, to the best of our abilities. It's just all of our venues have said no to us even meeting or being on premises. So it's going to be one of those set up real quick, do our thing, and then like dash off, hopefully, you know, without getting kicked out of, you know, the underground or the undercover area in the school lot or the park or something.
So and pushing it out is a great idea too. You don't have to do it this time of year.
If you're doing it in May, are you inviting your AOLs who crossed over back to compete?
They don't seem to have a strong desire to do it this year, but it's always, I would say, why not? I mean, they're still here with us and we still care about them. So yes, I would say, why not? I think that would be a great thing to do.
So one of the things that we've been debating as far as scheduling is, you know, when you're all in person and the scouts are able to hang out when their cars aren't racing or their dens aren't racing at that time, that works great. But if you're watching, you know, dozens of cars that are going down the track that are not your car, you may get super bored. So we were thinking about breaking out the heats such that they were kind of on schedules so that you could say, everyone from this den, your heat is going to be at 11 o'clock. And then the next den tune in at 11:20. And then everyone comes back together at like 2 p.m. to see the top racers. Otherwise, the scouts will be, you know, kind of sitting around and getting pretty bored while they're waiting for their car to eventually race and may even miss their car racing.
Yeah, I think that would be a great solution to that.
My pack is going to be holding our Pinewood Derby in January. We had a great deal of difficulty as well finding locations or a venue indoors. However, when I started calling churches in the Sammamish area, I got lots of welcome invitations to come in. So we're going to be holding our Pinewood on January 30th at a local church, and they've got internet access. They're going to allow us to use the restrooms. And again, this will be a virtual event. It'll just be a handful of adults running the races, and we plan on doing the races by den, and we'll invite everybody like to tune in on a Zoom link at a particular time to watch their cars race, and then we'll have a final competition or runoff for all the dens to see who the overall winner is and have that scheduled as well.
Matt, which church decided to let you guys do that? Is it SPC, maybe?
The Regeneration Church, okay. Right behind Safeway. And I also spoke to, Sammamish Presbyterian. Mm-hmm. They called me back second and offered the use of their facility as well.
Okay. Thanks.
Sure.
Okay. And you can always check with your charter organization because they should be providing you with meeting facilities in the normal course of a year. So even though they're not necessarily doing that for your PAC meetings, they may have ideas or suggestions and they can help guide you. So that's a great thing to double check with your charter organization rep. So it sounds like we kind of all have a consensus. We're going to do sort of a hybrid of the race. Is that, or does anyone disagree? Okay, well, I think that's perfect. That's the safe thing to do right now. It's not always the easiest, as Jamie was talking about. You do have to find a venue, and if you're gonna be outdoors, you know, you do need to mark 6 feet apart using cones or tape or something like that. So there is nothing stopping you from doing it. Our pack, we had a regular check-in. We have drive-through pack meetings. So during the drive-through pack meeting, the cars got turned in. The cars were quarantined with someone. And then the cars were taken by like 4 adults, I think, over to the church basement and recorded it from multiple angles and then live streamed it. So that the scouts could see what was going on. So that's exactly how my pack happened to solve that problem. But I think that there are a lot of valid ways. So I'm still interested to hear, you know, if anyone else has more on that.
Now for our rain gutter regatta, we don't have anybody in our pack leadership who's overly technically savvy when it comes to live streaming. So we just set up an iPad pointed at the rain gutters that were set up in one of our leaders' garages and just kind of did a check to make sure that everybody could see it over Zoom, and it worked pretty well.
That's awesome, yeah. Yeah, and there's no reason that you can't record and then post. In fact, I would probably suggest that over, you know, a Facebook Live type streaming event. As we know, people are trying to get into other people's meetings for silly purposes, and we don't want our scouts to be seeing that. So certainly make sure that you're using your internet safety rules as well to view the race. We have about 5 more minutes for discussion, and then I'm gonna wrap up the meeting. But I think, so what are your best tips and tricks pertaining, maybe not necessarily to the event, but to the making of the cars? Build nights are very popular. Having, you know, the whole den come over to one place to use a tool that a parent has or something with parent supervision. Make sure that you have the parents supervising, because you will not be at a day camp where the tools have been provided for you. And so you just don't want to take that extra liability.
Are any of your packs doing build nights right now?
Well, and that's a good point. No, I imagine most of them are not. So let's hash this out. What are you going to do for your build nights that you typically have, if you typically have them?
We've never done build nights. I think they're great going forward in non-COVID year. I'm going to implement it.
Sure, sure.
What we normally do is we have just the parents working with their child and then setting it up at home. My concern for this year is I have so many new families that have zero tools and skills. So I'm going to have to work through that with them and kind of go through the process.
And does your pack happen to have a subcommittee for the Pinewood Derby?
No.
Oh, okay. That's also another thing going forward that is useful to kind of employ, in the sense that whoever, you know, builds your track is going to have very different skills from the person planning the event, who has different skills from different parts of this. So this is a great event, and other events like these, to ask a parent for just, could you please do this specific task on this specific day, and then you'll be done. And then they'll see, okay, volunteering isn't going to bite me. they're actually nice people. So that's something to consider as well. Did anyone have, specific questions about the virtual races that haven't been answered? Because Laura, I know you had kind of brought that up first thing.
Sounds like we're all trying to figure it out at the same time.
Yeah. Well, yeah, that's kind of the fun of Roundtable, right? We all get together and figure it out, and we each try it out in our own different way and with our pack's different personality and see what sticks, right?
I guess a suggestion I have, and this is something that I was going to email to Matt at a different time, but it would be really nice if the packs in Sammamish could just combine for this event and do it together and have one person lead it and the other, you know, people in the different packs help out in some way. Maybe as a fundraiser or something, but it would be really nice that way we wouldn't all have to do our separate events, but one huge one that would be really, really fun.
I will definitely make sure that Chris is listening right now. I will tell you that we normally have a district Pinewood Derby that we hold in approximately April, but due to low attendance the past several years, and knowing that we didn't know when COVID would be at an end, we decided not to host one this year. So I don't see why that doesn't mean that we couldn't work something else out. And for all of those of you who don't have my email address, it's KHRESSLER@iCloud.com. please don't hesitate to reach out to me with ideas like that, and I will forward them on to Todd and Ken and Chris, and make sure that your ideas are heard, certainly.
I'd like to speak to Jamie's question. RPAC 586 is actually working in conjunction with Boy Scout Troop 575. They offered to run our Pinewood Derby for us and wanted to reach out and invite Cub Scout PACs, you know, throughout Sammamish, I mean, throughout King County. Anybody who wanted to join is welcome to come and join in. And the Boy Scout Troop that was going to host this for us, their intention was to try to use this as a like a form of a fundraiser. So yes, you know, you are all welcome to join us if you like. Just please reach out to me.
That's an amazing offer right there. It's very generous. Thank you, Matt.
Sure.
Yeah, and again, I think Laura's going to hit the nail on the head when she said we're all working it out. Is there anything that you've tried maybe with your online meetings or events that, just doesn't work no matter how hard you try? Are there any thorns that we can forewarn each other about?
Well, I mean, there are some very basic things that you learn real quick, like never give your scouts control of the screen. Make sure you know how to mute all. Those are some pretty critical skills to learn. Knowing all the Zoom shortcut keys, highly important.
I'm sorry. I have a sore throat and you made me laugh so hard. But yes, sometimes, you know, we hear these studies about doctors who follow a checklist versus those who don't, and they have a much lower rate of infection and things like that. Often we forget our basics, don't we? It wasn't even something I really included in this. So I think, yeah, back to basics and also arming your leadership with the knowledge. You know, you might have three new tiger dens, and not one of the leaders is necessarily going to know how to do this, right? So someone's going to have to teach them. And it's good if you have more than one person in the pack that can say, hey, let me guide you through this. And then you can be, you know, like learning like a Jacob's ladder. Okay, so the National Council, or I'm sorry, was there anything else anyone wanted to discuss here? Because it's your time and I want you to ask any questions. None is too silly. Okay, thanks guys. Other style races are Rangata Regatta and Space Derby is what we would have looked at. And they are very fun and we will discuss the variations at some point if you want. For our safety moment, I've actually gone with something a little different. A friend of mine, I've been having a rough couple of months and I really haven't known how to handle it. So my friend reminded me, are you taking care of yourself? Are you being kind to yourself? Or are you just letting all this stress happen? And I realized, uh-oh, I'm just letting the stress build up. So while this month is the perfect opportunity to go out and provide service and do projects and make donations and show our reverence, remember your sanity is very, very important too, because it is. And I don't know if this is going to work at this point, but I really hope. If you're familiar with the show Twin Peaks, that's what this is from.
like some coffee?
Afternoon, you can't hear it.
Yes, but we should be on our way.
Good. Mary, thanks.
I'm going to let you in on a little secret. Every day, once a day, give yourself a present. Don't plan it. Don't wait for it. Just let it happen. It could be a new shirt at the men's store, a cat nap in your office chair, or 2 cups of good, hot, black coffee. Like this. Like Christmas. Nothing like a great cup of black coffee.
So basically, that's my way of saying stop, make sure that you have your cup of coffee, or you take your bath, or you go for that hike on your own that you've been wanting to take and you felt guilty about taking the time. Remember, your sanity is very important as well. I did want to start doing something at the end of our roundtables, which is just if you have any questions for the district or about your PACs, we will have time to just unrelated topics. So, you know, like even if we're discussing recharter and you have questions about Pinewood Derby, you know, you could discuss them at this point going forward. So we will have this slide in. And I'm also making a reminder to check in with your unit commissioner if you haven't lately. They are a person who is there to help you. They're kind of the next step up. Then you can bring it to roundtable above them. And then if ultimately you need to talk to Ken or Todd, that's what needs to happen. But they're really there to help and guide you. And if you just touch base, it will help your unit stay strong because you'll be addressing issues in real time. So does anyone have any of those pesky questions?
I have one. I'm wondering about the scouting for food. Are we doing that this year, you think?
I don't.
So in some fashion, yes. So last year we didn't have like a single day where, you know, we asked everyone to go out and collect the food. You know, suggest that units can go out and do their own kind of food drives and just kind of email us the information that we could, you know, then post. And I don't know what it's going to look like in 2021. Normally we have our scouting for food in, when do we have
March.
It? March, okay.
Yeah.
Like late March, I think. So we'll probably put out some kind of more information at that point. Or as we get closer, probably in February for that. But I think there's a good chance it'll be, you know, asked for units to do it on their own level and just kind of submit how many pounds of food were donated sort of thing.
Yeah, it may look a little bit different this year, right? I mean, you may be asking families to go out and collect the food in lieu of sending out groups of scouts, right? So.
Right.
And again, use those resources, virtually reach out to people and say, my scout is collecting food. This is if you want to, of course. Jamie, did that answer that? Okay, awesome. Does anyone else have any just unrelated questions? Okay, so I am going to, please speak up if you do. I can't see everything necessarily on my screen, so just shout at me if you do. I would ask that we're gonna send out the bonus email like we always do. It'll come from Eric or Michael. All of the links will be in there. And then look out for a survey. I would very much like to hear from you what topics you would like covered the rest of the year, because it is a strange year and there are different things that need to be covered. I know that you know, it's sometimes hard for the den leaders when I'm doing committee side, sometimes hard for the committee when something's very den based. So we do try to give you those topics in advance, but I would really value any of your input when I do send that out. It would be amazing. And on behalf of Wendy and myself, have a blessed and safe, happy new year and happy holidays. If you celebrate, happy Hanukkah tonight. And we can't wait to see you back in January.
Thanks, everybody. Yeah.
Thank you, Kat.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
And thank you for our awards. It was wonderful. Thank you so much.
Oh, congratulations. Well earned.